Today, let us see the overview of GST, means the basic things you need to know about GST in Indian scenario. Okay, so the main objectives you need to know that what is direct and indirect tax, then how the implementation was done in India, then what are the taxes to be subsumed into GST, what are the taxes that were prevailing in the earlier scenario, and which are the taxes that subsumed into GST, then framework of GST as well as advantages and benefits of GST. So we will learn all these points in this video. Introduction. See, what is tax? That is actually derived from the Latin word tax. Okay, and what does it mean? It is a mandatory financial charge that is imposed upon a taxpayer, okay, by the government. Means the government is collecting a amount, okay, from the taxpayers to meet various public expenditures. It can include education, defense, agriculture, law and safety, administration, all these expenses government has to meet. You just imagine how our government schools are running, okay, or defense. We have the largest defense system in the world. Okay, so how it is managed, how it is administered, how so much cost is involved. Okay, again, agriculture, there are various subsidies, then various schemes for farmers or other communities, then law and safety, how our courts are running. Okay, then administration, okay, IAS, IPS, IF, everything is there. Okay, so the government has to manage all these expenses. Then a failure to pay along with evasion of or resistance to taxation. See, suppose any person is refusing, I cannot give tax, then government can impose penalty or impose punishments. Okay, and tax is a contribution by the individual for the development of the country. Why we want to contribute? Because it is a contribution from our part to the nation, for nation development. See, we use roads, we use bridges, we use various systems and facilities offered by government. So all these things need cost, are incurring cost. So we need to contribute to the government. Okay, then coming to the tax, we need to understand what is the difference between direct tax and indirect tax. Okay, what is direct tax? Direct tax is levied on the income of individuals or organizations. It is directly on the income of a particular person. Suppose a person have a income, annual income of 6 or 7 lakhs. Then on that 6 or 7 lakhs, the income tax is calculated on an annual year basis. Okay, for each financial year, we need to calculate tax on income. That is called income tax. And what this person has to do, he has to remit so much tax to the government. That is called income tax. And the person is bearing the tax and aware of his tax burden. The person knows, in this financial year I got so much income and I want to pay so much tax. Okay, so the person is already knowing his liability and he has to discharge, he has to pay so much tax to the government. Okay, then coming to indirect tax, who is paying it? All consumers are paying it. For example, you know, do you know how many persons are paying income tax? It is just around 3% of total population only. See, we have 125 crores population in India. Only 3% is paying income tax. But see, how many persons are paying indirect tax, means GST? Everybody is paying. Because whenever we are purchasing any goods or services, for example, we are buying any laptop, we are buying any car, or we are buying any even toothbrush or detergent powder, anything, then we need to pay GST. That is called indirect tax. So all 125 crores people has to pay GST. Okay, And ultimate customer is bearing the tax burden. Here the customer has to bear the tax burden. Then it doesn't matter whether the customer is rich or poor, he has to pay GST. Means in case of income tax, only rich people has to pay. There is a slab system. There is a exemption limit up to 5 lakhs. Then again, there is a tax person above 5 lakhs. There is another percentage of income tax. It all comes. But regard to GST, indirect tax, there is no difference between rich and poor. Then, let us learn what is indirect tax. See, indirect tax is governed by central government and state governments. Earlier, before GST, central government was levying tax on manufacture of goods as well as services. What was the tax on manufacture? It was central excise duty. And what was the tax on services? It was service tax. Both these taxes were governed or collected by central government only. But coming to state government, they were dealing with the sale of goods as well as interstate sale of goods. What was the tax prevailing on sale of goods? It was what? Value added tax. Then what was the tax on interstate sale of goods? It was central sales tax. Okay, so all these tax were prevailing before GST in India. Yeah, coming to change in constitution, we can understand that the constitution of India has been amended by the Constitution 101st Amendment Act 2016. Means our constitution was changed. Okay, earlier the central government has its own had its own powers and state government had its own powers to collect tax. But when GST had to be implemented in India, there was a need of change in the constitution. Okay, then Article 246A of the constitution came and it gave a power to both central government and state government to levy GST on both goods and services. So what happened now? Central government can collect tax on both goods and services, as well as state government can also collect tax on goods and services. Then, let us see milestones in GST. Okay, what are the various milestones that happened in the implementation of GST in India? Actually, it was a long journey, about 16, 17 years. Okay, so in 2000, Mr. Atal Bihari Vajpayee, our former Prime Minister, suggested about GST. Then in 2004, task force headed by Mr. Vijay L. Kalkar, he was an advisor to the Finance Ministry. He suggested that the indirect tax system should be changed and new GST should be implemented. Then in 2006, Mr. P. Chidambaram, then Finance Minister, presented the GST concept in his budget speech in 2006-2007 when he presented the budget. Then in 2014, the Constitution Amendment Bill was presented in Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. Again, 2014, it was referred to Joint Committee of Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha to study on GST. In 2016, the bill was passed by the lower and upper house of the parliament. In 2016. Again, 2016 ratification by state legislatures and assent by the Honorable President was done. Again, 2017 approval of the GST Council as well as GST bills were enacted. Okay. Then it is 2017 legislatures and assent by the Honorable President was done. So all these were the main steps to implement GST in India. Okay. Now let us learn which are the main acts or bills you need to study in GST scenario. One is Central Goods and Service Tax Act 2017. The second is Integrated Goods and Service Tax Act 2017. Third is Union Territory GST Act 2017, as well as GST Compensation to States Act 2017. Okay, so these are the bills, main bills which was implemented in India on implementation of GST. Then let us understand what is GST. GST is a system similar to what system levied at national level. Okay, so it was implemented on a national level and it is applicable to all states, union territories, central government, state government, goods, services, everything. Okay, then features. It is a indirect tax levy, it is not a direct tax. Then it is levied only on manufacture, sale and consumption of goods and services, etc. Means wherever the goods or services are handled, it is applicable. Then consumption based multi-point sales tax means it is a multi-point tax, means it is applicable on production, wholesale distribution, retail, sale to customer, everything, all stages it is applicable. Then when the goods are sold, tax is calculated on value addition only. Okay, when we are selling goods, how much value is added, on that value it is the GST is calculated. Let us see an example later. Then what are the various rate? It comes to zero rate, 0.25, 3, 5, 12, 18 and 28. These are the various tax rates that is applicable. Then what is GST? See, GST is ultimately borne by the final consumer. I already told you that 100% of the persons or 100% people are paying indirect tax. So all customers, whenever they are purchasing any goods or services, they need to pay GST according to the GST law. Okay, so here you can see one customer is there, then a business person is there, then a GST department is there. Okay, so this is how the GST transaction is done. When the customer is receiving any goods or services, they need to pay GST to the business person, and the business person has to pay this tax to the government like that. So this is the flow. The supplies referred to in GST system are classified as intrastate supplies and interstate supplies. We will understand it. There is a intrastate supply and interstate supply. It simply means, intrastate means within the state. Suppose a person in Karnataka sells goods from Mysore to Bangalore. Both places are in Karnataka. So it is called intrastate. And when any person is selling goods from his state to another state, say from Bangalore to Delhi, in that case it is called interstate supply. Okay, then there can be zero rated supplies, nil rated, exempt supply. We will learn all about it. Okay, all these points we'll cover. Then there is a concept called input tax credit also. Okay, so these are the main things which you need to know about GST. Then let us understand the framework of GST. What is dual GST? Dual GST means both central and state governments levy tax on goods and services. Okay, here both central government and state governments are levying tax. Okay, that is why we call it as dual GST. Do you know from which country we adopted GST? Or in how many countries GST is there? GST is there in 160 countries. Okay, and it was first implemented in France, and later in many countries it was adopted, and India is 161st country. Okay, then you can see that GST extends to the all of India including Jammu and Kashmir. Then the goods are classified using HSN codes. Okay, there is a harmonized system of nomenclature code. Then GST registration is applicable whenever the person is exceeding the threshold limit. Then composition scheme is there, which is suitable for small traders and manufacturers. Then you should know that certain goods and services are exempted. GST is not applicable on all goods and services. Okay. Then let us see which are the central taxes that subsumed into GST. Central excise duty, duties of excise, that is medicinal and toilet preparations, additional duties of excise, that is textiles and textile products, additional duties of excise, that is goods of special importance. Then additional duties of customs, that is commonly known as CVD. Then special additional duty of customs, service tax, central surcharges and cesses, so far as their relative supply of goods and services. All these taxes, those were managed by central government, that subsumed into GST. Okay. Then coming to state taxes that were subsumed into GST include state VAT, central sales tax. What is VAT and CST? VAT was for intrastate transactions. Okay, mainly. Then if you are purchasing for from any other state, say the Karnataka person is purchasing from Delhi state, then CST was applicable, central sales tax. And the luxury tax, entry tax, entertainment and amusement tax, advertisement, purchase tax. So all these taxes were subsumed into GST. Okay. Then which are the principles that were adopted on implementation of GST? So the first principle was that it was levied on supply of goods and services, not on individuals or corporates like that. It is an indirect tax levy and it was levied on goods and services. Then tax or levy should be part of the transaction or supply chain. Okay, and it should be related to import, manufacture, production. Okay, all these activities were applicable. Then free flow of tax credit. See, input tax credit was available. You will understand better in the another chapter. So a person who is taking registration can claim the tax paid to his suppliers. Okay, then revenue fairness for both union and state governments, means both central and state governments should get benefit out of the GST. So those were the principles adopted. And coming to the benefits, the main benefit is removal of cascading effect. Cascading effect means tax on tax. Suppose we purchased any goods from outside the state, we were paying central sales tax, and when we are supplying in the state, we were charging VAT on that central sales tax also. I will give another example, then you can better understand. Then common national market. Common national market means earlier there were a lot of checkposts. Now it is removed. So it became a common national market. Do you know, in developed countries, one truck was moving 700 to 800 kilometers in a day. But in India, it was just about 200 and 250 kilometers, means one third of the distance were only covered by the transport vehicles. The main reason was all these checkposts and all other anomalies. Okay, so it was removed. Then common classification mechanism, that is HSN and service codes, were implemented. Input tax credit means whenever we purchase any goods or services and we are paying any tax to the our suppliers, that tax can be deducted from our tax liability. I will give another example. Then reduction in price for exports, there is no GST for exports. Then higher threshold, 20 lakhs is implemented. Now it became 44 goods. Okay, so that was implemented. Then gain for central and state governments, simple and transparent system, all these were the benefits. But as you learned, GST was implemented in all these 160 countries. India is 161st. In all these countries, when GST was implemented, there were a lot of problems. There were a lot of challenges. But in India, we almost covered the initial problems. Now GST is 2 years old. Okay, so now I think it will get streamlined. Government is putting lot of efforts, taking further steps. So let us hope GST will be very good in the coming days. Okay, so in this chapter we have covered the basic things. Hope you understood this chapter. Thank you.